Hello, this is Crane Song from Twitch Chat, and you're listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
Hello, this is Sparse Vector, the creator of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, and you're listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
This is Sailor, Mr. of the Grendel Podcast, and you are listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
This is Chan Man V of Wednesday Night Sprites and Climbing the Ladder, and you're listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
Hey yo, what up world? I go by the name of Tempo from Team Infinity 7, and you are listening to my brother Sinvicta on SS Radio.
Hello, this is Nick Axat Ranish from Major League Gaming, and you're listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
Live on Twitch TV and on the VODs here on YouTube.com, it's SS Radio! 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 And now, here's your host, Sinvicta. Up, what is going on? A tremendous Tuesday evening to all here live and in person. It is SS Radio number 94. Today is September 10th, 2013. My name is Sinvicta, and I am the host of SS Radio, coming at you live here on twitch.tv/Sinvicta, also broadcasting here on the VODs on YouTube.com. Go to my YouTube channel, youtube.com/Sinvicta316, for all of the, well, all of the more recent SS radios, and that is something I'm going to have to talk about later on in tonight's show, but we do have a very, very awesome show for you today, and before I get into that, I will say that I am happy that football is back. Now, for those of you who do not know me well enough or do not know me personally, you would know that I am a huge football fan. I play fantasy football. I played football for many, many years, and I am all around just happy. I am the happiest when it's football season. The unhappiest that I am in during football season is usually after the first week, after I realize that nothing has changed in Tampa Bay, because Tampa Bay is still awful if they still have Josh Freeman being the quarterback, and that my fantasy football team lost because Peyton Manning decided to put up 78 points by himself. And for those of you who don't know what that means, that's basically like him hitting a home run every single inning that he was at bat and your team not hitting anything. It's that kind of devastation. So there's a couple reasons why I am kind of bummed tonight. I might sound a little bit down, and it's not because I'm depressed or anything like that, but I am upset that the Buccaneers still suck and that my fantasy team, who, by the way, I was graded at the number one position in our league. I got the highest report card. I'm supposed to be projected to have the most points in my fantasy football league, which is nothing out of the ordinary, because let's face it, I'm going to only be playing people who are worse than I am, but then I lose to a guy who doesn't even watch football, and it's because of only one player, Peyton Manning, who went completely just berserk on Thursday against the Ravens. So there is that. But if you've never seen a live showing of SS Radio, then I welcome you out to the show. And if you're actually hearing to this for the first time here on my YouTube channel, if you're one of my new thousands of subscribers that I've actually gained in the past month or so, then I say, I invite you to come check out a live showing of SS Radio. It's a lot of fun. We do a lot of fun bits before, during, and after every single SS Radio, including the super amazing SS Radio Wagon Adventure. We saw Angelicar unceremoniously get just bucked, I guess, after the first, after her reappearance, her reemergence back in the Wagon Adventure. She was killed off, and then we still have Sorar, who's the champion. And hilariously enough, Husky was in the last, in the pregame show. And Husky subsequently died, and then before he died, we found a traveler named David, and I assumed that it was TGS David. It looked like him, and then Husky ended up dying, and TGS David ended up pretty much destroying everybody. So, but it was going to be Sorar and David, so congratulations on that. But here we go. This is how we do it. A fun show tonight. I count back from 3, 2, 1, and then I show you the topic. So 3, 2, 1. There they are, the topics. I don't know. XSplit did like some kind of crazy upgrade. Now switching the scenes is like heavily delayed by a second or two. Here's the topics for tonight. SS Radio number 94. I'm going to be covering what I alluded to in the beginning of this show, which was the fact that you can find most of the SS radios on YouTube now, not all of them, and I will cover that along with the main topic, which is going to be why people still use Adblock and why I coincidentally have stopped using Adblock Plus on YouTube anyway, and for Twitch as well. Also going to be giving you my thoughts on Final Fantasy. They shattered their expectations. The digital sales are still, or the hold on the digital sales of copies of Final Fantasy XIV is still in effect right now with no end in sight. The game continues to grow, however, which is very, very awesome indeed because it's a very, very good game. I'm also going to be giving you my thoughts on, and actually I may be doing a little bit of crowdsourcing on this next one for topic number three, talking about the Air Amazing series. For those of you who are subscribed to my YouTube channel, you will know that I've been doing a particularly very popular series, for my standards anyway, called Air Amazing, which is basically me playing ARAMs, all random, all middle games in League of Legends, and that has been taking off, and I have been enjoying the popularity of that. But I do have a couple people asking me how come I, or ways that I would do that in Dota, and I'll give you my thoughts on that, because I am looking, I am trying to figure out ways that I can do that, but I haven't really gotten an idea that sounds good. Let's put it that way. And then coming up for the hypothetical, I'll give you the hypothetical right now, and this is one that I guarantee you everyone is going to like out there. I'll give you the hypothetical question. Again, these hypothetically speakings, keep your answers to yourselves until I ask for them when we, well, there's not going to be any breaks, but trust me, I'll ask for them. Hypothetically speaking, if dogs were as smart as humans since the beginning of time, would they have become the most dominant species on Earth, or would humans still be the dominant species on Earth? And boy, oh boy, the spider one was fun, but now we're talking about an animal that pretty much most humans like. I know there's a couple people who aren't dog fans out there, but you can find a lot more people who don't like spiders. But yeah, so this one is, hypothetically speaking, if dogs were as smart as humans since the beginning of time, would dogs have become the most dominant species on Earth, or would it still be humans? And then last but certainly not least, I'm going to give you an update on the Word of Lauder album. We are nearing completion of the final song. Well, we're about maybe 30% of the way, maybe 25%, more like 10% of the way done with the final song on the album. Just giving you a quick update on that because I do have more people asking where they can find my music and whatnot. But that'll be at the end of the show. Right back up to the top here, I'm going to be covering out why I don't use Adblock anymore, and I figured out why people do use Adblock. I was quickly reminded as soon as I disabled my Adblock Plus on YouTube why I used it in the first place. And that is because YouTube has the hilarious tendency to give you unskippable ads. Now, for those of you who are not in the know, when you become a YouTube partner, or if you're a part of a network, when they are allowed to place ads on your videos, you have the option to pick the type of ad that is going to go on your video. And the only reason why I even know anything about this subject now is because, spoiler alert, yes, I am now an official YouTube partner. That was made official about 5 or 6 days ago. I'm very excited. That's a big, big, huge step. The fact that you can, well, let me put it this way, to put everything in perspective, I'd say less than a 0.1 part of a 1% chance of people who actually put content on YouTube, are able to actually monetize their videos. And I am, of course, lucky enough to have the friends that I do and to be able to produce the content that I can. Don't get it twisted. The only reason why I am in this position is because of Husky. 100% because of Husky. It's not many of my undoing, or my doing anyway. It's not because I'm super duper awesome or good or whatever, you know, at the things that I do. It is because Husky is the one who has voluntarily and unselfishly been promoting me for the past couple of months now. I've known him for, me and Husky have been good friends for a couple years now, I guess. And I know how extremely lucky I am. Let's put it that way. I know very, very how I don't want to say blessed because I don't like that word, but I know how privileged I am to have a friend like Husky, and also friends like TGS David, who was co-founder of the Game Station, by the way. So yes, I am now an official YouTube partner. That does not mean that I'm rolling around in oodles of YouTube dollars. I don't really like to talk monetary figures when it comes to my finances on this show, but I will say is this. Right now, with the amount of traffic that I produce on my channel, I make roughly about enough to buy a Subway sandwich per month. Let's put it that way. That is about how much I currently get. So you can do the math there. Monthly, that is my monthly take. Let's put it that way. So it's not a lot of money. It's certainly not enough to keep me going or pay any bills or anything like that. But hey, it's a start. And again, a fraction of a percentage of people who actually start YouTube are able to get into the position that I am, where you actually become a full-time partner, especially without a network. And by the way, that's something else I also have to say is that no, I'm not part of any network. I'm not part of the GameStation yet. I'm not part of Polaris. Probably not going to be part of that anytime soon, but I am just a full-out, full-fledged YouTube partner, and I do want to thank everyone out there who listens and watches my channel for letting me do that. Above all else, I have to thank you, the watcher, the listener of my content, because without you, even all the help from Husky wouldn't have mattered because you didn't follow me here. But enough about that. Going back to my main point of this topic is that now that I am a YouTube partner, and I will say that I do disable Adblock for friends, but it's very, very, very small portion of my friends that I disabled Adblock Plus. By the way, I'm talking about Adblock Plus, not Adblock. There is a difference. They're made by two different people, and the one that you want to get is Adblock Plus, because the original Adblock is a scam and a waste of time. I'm not going to go into that. Trust me on that. Use ABP. But traditionally, even before I became a YouTube partner, I would disable Adblock for such channels such as Husky, such as Roe as well, Rosanna Pantino, the Game Station, Dodger, TB, of course, and a couple other of my friends that I subscribe to. But for the most part, I usually keep it on whenever I'm just surfing around YouTube, trying to find out songs or this and that. And now that I've disabled it for all of YouTube, because I don't want to be a hypocrite, I remembered why I actually use Adblock, and this is probably the reason why you use Adblock. It's because those stupid, unskippable ads that are like 15 to 30 seconds long, and if you try to refresh the page, guess what? You get the same ad started over again, and that is something that I feel like new media is going to have to change eventually. Now, new media is not to the point where it is going to keep pace with television, not anytime in the near future anyway, but I believe one day the new media will indeed give TV a run for its money. It's already done that on consoles and other streaming services like Netflix, etc., etc. And all that being said, commercials don't really hurt TV. I do know that people some family members of mine, they actually record their shows in advance, and then they watch it a day later so they can just fast-forward all the commercials. And I think that really is getting to the point of what YouTube is doing, and I'm only specifically talking about YouTube right now because I don't go to any other video streaming service out there, or new media service, rather. But there should be, I feel like there should be a limit as far as how many ads one particular IP address is able to consume without actually being shown another one. I do think that it is a little silly, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, but I do believe that there is somewhat of a soft cap on how many ads one IP address can be shown within like the first hour or something like that. But one thing that is dumb is those unskippable ads, and that is something that I do have a problem with. And by the way, I will state for the record that the ads that I have chosen on my videos are usually the ones that have you watch it for 5 seconds, click skip, and then that's fine. If you want to watch the entire ad, that's fine. I don't believe that produces any more money on the view, but I could be wrong. Again, this is all kind of new to me. I've only been an official YouTube partner for, like I said, about 5 or 6 days, if that. I think it's actually lower than that. But anyway, what I would say is that if you want to give feedback for the type of ads that you do and don't like, there is an option to mute ads. There's an option to send feedback on YouTube here. You can click on the I believe some ads actually have a mute this ad button. It'd be the Xbox on the top right-hand side. No pun intended with that. And you can mute it, and that will actually send feedback to Google and AdSense telling them basically, hey, this ad is inappropriate, it's getting marked down or whatever. So I highly encourage you to do that. No, this is not me pleading for you to stop using ABP on my Twitch channel or my YouTube channel or anything like that. I'm not a Twitch partner. I only very, very recently became a YouTube partner. And like I said, the difference between between you, me asking like the 18 people that are listening to the show right now and maybe the other 50 or 60 people who listen here on the VOD, it's not going to make much of a difference where I'm like, oh man, I get to pay my light bill next month or something like that. But if you do consider it, that'd be cool. If not, hey, that is no big deal. And frankly, I do not blame you at all. Now, the ones that I do think that are really ridiculous are the Twitch ads. And Rotate Al's just brought that up as well. I think Twitch TV really needs to get a little bit of a lockdown on how their ads are rolled out. I do know that you can join. If someone were to refresh my channel right now, they would get an ad played. And for some reason, if the stream stopped or if something stuttered, they had to refresh it again, they would get another ad that's playing. There's no sort of limiter on the amount of ads that Twitch has currently for their partners. But again, I am not a partner with Twitch, and that is, I'm just not a partner with Twitch because frankly, I just don't stream. It's not stream enough right now. But I do feel like there are some companies that do kind of that tend to abuse the whole ad thing and the ad revenue, and I feel like Twitch is one of those companies that they don't really technically abuse it, but it's also running around without any sort of limiters or any limitations on that. And I do feel like Adblock Plus on Twitch channels that you don't want to support or don't care about, by all means, use it. Lord knows I'm not going to sit up here and tell you that I don't use Adblock on Twitch, because I do. The only channels I actually turn off Adblock for are people that I like Root Cats, who's a friend of mine who I actually mod for his channel, Husky, of course, Total Biscuit, who a couple more people, Boogie2988, who, by the way, he's just started to stream more regularly these days. I'm trying to think of a couple other Twitch channels. Tempo, of course, but Tempo's not a—he's not a Twitch partner. Idra and Destiny, and I'm trying to Kriparian, Krip, and Tally too. I recently unblocked Tally on Adblock Plus too, because I've been talking with him. Tally's a cool guy, but. Long story short, Adblock is pretty nice indeed. I'm not going to tell you to not use it on my channel. Again, I don't blame you for using it. If you do decide to turn it off for my channel, then by all means do it. It certainly helps, but it doesn't make that much of a difference. Let's put it that way. Not right now, anyway. And yes, I am very, very happy, and I'm very privileged and lucky to be able to call myself a full YouTube partner, and that will not change any kind of content that you will see for me, other than the fact that this last final announcement is that you will notice that I've actually recently removed more videos, including, and begrudgingly so, I begrudgingly had to remove the SS Radio highlight reels. And I know that's going to come as a shock to some people. Others are going to understand why now that I'm talking about me being an actual YouTube partner. But I definitely didn't want to. And trust me, I fought as hard as I could to keep those videos up. But eventually, the people who are more important than me and more experienced in the matter told me that I pretty much just have to take them down. So the SS Radio highlight reels are now gone. Most of the SS radios that you will find are also gone. Every single archive show, even the ones, the important interview ones, like the one with Axelab, the one with Sparse Vector, I had to take those down. And I look at that as kind of like, it's just these, I don't want to call them sacrifices, because it's not like I'm killing them, but it is, it's necessary, I guess. I look at them as jumping through hoops here. And the reason why I did that is because some of the music that I used, which I'm no longer able to play, and that's also the reason why I don't do breaks anymore. Some of the music that I use, I was using under the false pretense that it was commercial free or is royalty free music. You didn't have to have a license for it, and that you can monetize it forever you want. And I never made this show for the sole purpose of monetizing them anyway, but it certainly would have helped that I don't have to worry about copyright notice or anything like that. Well, that false pretense was indeed just that. It was a very false pretense, and even though the website that I got those tracks from, which, by the way, coincidentally enough, those are the tracks that you used to hear on MLG broadcasts. I got it from the same website that MLG did, and clear as day on the right there in the small print, it said these are royalty free commercial or license free music tracks. You can use them for anything you want, fair trade, etc., etc. And that's the reason why I did it. Well, now they're gone. So, and I was told by YouTube that no, indeed, those are actually content ID owned by a certain company, and that certain company would not allow me to keep them on my channel. So there you go. sacrifices had to be made, but hey, you know what? That's all part of the thing. If anything, the only thing that I really feel sad about is how many thousands of hours I poured into getting all those videos, including the Lauder videos, of course, which you can still find, by the way, warcraftmovies.com. Search for Lauder or Sinvicta. You'll find all my War of Law episodes. But I definitely, losing the SS Radio highlight reels definitely hurt. That one kind of kicked me in the ding-ding there. But unfortunately, it had to be done. And that is the process. I'm just calling it the due process. And that is all I'm going to say about that, because I have to move on to topic number two, really quickly discussing Final Fantasy XIV. Yes, I've been loving it. And yes, I did put out my very first Final Fantasy video on the YouTube channel, which coincidentally, hilariously enough, was not blocked by monetization or copyright, anything like that. The one game that I've actually made, or the one game that I've actually filmed in the past month, that you would think would be like, okay, there's no way in hell that is going to be able to be monetized, is actually gets completely monetized, and like I think I've made like 3 cents on that video, which is hilarious. But another game that you may have heard, you may not have heard, that which actually gets immediately rejected is Hearthstone, and I'm going to be talking about Hearthstone in a second. But back to Final Fantasy real quick. Final Fantasy sales, they've shattered expectations of everybody. The game is doing phenomenally well, and rightfully so, because it's a phenomenal game. Yeah, I said it. It is a worthy successor to Final Fantasy XI. I still do have a couple problems with it, but for the most part, the game is awesome. It is a worthy successor. I'm enjoying my time when I'm actually able to play it and whatnot. And I'm also looking forward to recording all the Primal Fights. I did release the Primal Fight last week of me versus Ifrit, or Ifrit, however you want to pronounce it. And all the other Primals in there, like Titan, Odin, Rama, Ramu are out there. I'm hopefully will be able to fight. I think I'm approaching Titan. I'm about maybe 5 levels away from fighting Titan, and I have seen that video. Holy butts, that fight looks incredible, and I cannot wait to show you that. But for the most part, Final Fantasy XIV sales have been doing very, very well. However, Square has not lifted the hold on digital sales. Right now, for those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, Final Fantasy XIV exceeded so many expectations that Square was actually forced to pull the digital sale of the game because their servers could not handle the popularity, could not handle the traffic. And they've expanded their servers, they've added more, they've increased the population caps, and they still can't handle the amount of people that are trying to play their game, and that's great, that is awesome. I like these kind of problems. And no, it's not because I'm paid by Square, no, because I'm not half Chinese or half Japanese or whatever you want to call me. It's just because I think that the game deserves it. The game certainly deserved the second life. I was 100% wrong. I made my full apology with the whole rant that I did a couple weeks ago on SS Radio talking about how, they're in NDA. I'm dropping the mic, herpa derpa. So I manned up. I apologized. And the game is rightfully so that awesome. You should definitely play it. If you're lucky enough to find a copy of it in GameStop or Best Buy or wherever those evil corporations make your purchase from. I've heard they may even sell them in Walmart. I'm not quite sure. I cannot confirm that because the last time I went to Walmart, I think it was like 3 years ago. But I am on the server Lamia, however you want to pronounce it, L-A-M-I-A. My name is Sinvicta. That's my first name. Last name is like Divinus or something. I was just going for a random Latin word that I could find. And I fully welcome everyone to play with me. I'm going to make a fan link show. I don't know what it's going to be called. It's probably going to be called Followers of Sinvicta or just Sinvicta. That'd probably be easy. So if you are playing the game, and or if you're thinking about playing the game and you want to play with me, by all means, I am looking forward to playing with everyone out there. We don't have to make a guild. Link shells are basically chat channels. And think of link shells as like it is your own personal walkie-talkie to talk with other people who have the link shell. It's not a guild. You're not like bound by it. You can have as many link shells as you want. It's just a chat group at that. And I can hand out as many link shells or link pearls if you want to call them that, because that's what they're called in Final Fantasy XI. And join me on Lamia. It's a lot of fun. Game is phenomenal. I'm playing it all the time. And more. Moving on here to topic number 3, SS Radio number 94. As I said at the beginning of the show, you will know that one of my most, if not the most popular series that I have on my channel right now is called Air Amazing, and it basically focuses on me playing random Air Amazing games, or ARAM games, all random, all middle games in League of Legends. And sometimes I play with fans, sometimes I play with Huskies, sometimes I play with actual pros, which, by the way, without spoiling too much, I think it's the next... I want to say it's one or two episodes from now where I actually play with a couple people. One of them happens to be a professional law player. At least I think he's a professional law player. But he has a very, very huge YouTube channel based on nothing but League of Legends. I'm not going to spoil it for you, but he's very well known. And I actually we did a five man with that person, and that will be on my channel this week at some point. Check it out. But I did have a couple people asking me who don't particularly like League of Legends. They prefer Dota. They said, why can't you do something for Dota? Did you stop playing Dota, et cetera, et cetera? And the answer is no, I have not stopped playing Dota. I just don't, right now, I don't find the time to play Dota. And the one thing I will say about Dota, if I do have a couple criticisms that I will give League of Legends over Dota 2, is that Dota games, they can... I made a tweet about it about a week and a half ago, or maybe 2 weeks ago, where I said, Dota... The only thing I don't like, one of the few things I don't like about Dota, is that the game can be decided and over, like an unwinnable situation, in the first 15 minutes, but it will take another 50 minutes to end because the other game can't kill you, or the other team can't kill you, and you can't kill them, and it's just kind of like a war of attrition at that point. But your team is an unwinnable position at that point. And that's another thing that kind of turns me off to Dota right now, because League of Legends, I can just load up an ARAM game and in and out, 15, 20 minutes and you're done type thing. Whereas Dota, it's like 15, 20 minutes. All right, now I'm going to start working on level 14 or something like that. But one of the things that a lot of people have been asking me is, why don't I do something like Air Amazing for Dota 2? And I've always wanted to do that. But the problem is, number one, it takes a long time to actually try to get used to a new character in Dota 2. You can't just randomly jump and say, oh, today I'm going to play Faceless Void, or oh, I'm going to play Puck today. It's not quite as user-friendly as League of Legends. But I'm not scared, though. I'm not scared. I do play the hardest hero. The hardest hero in Dota is my main, is Invoker. So I'm not afraid of a challenge. But the problem is that is a challenge that is going to cost me at least 35 minutes to 1 hour before I'm like, okay, this game, like, there's no way I'm going to show this game. And I also get, and this is going to address a couple people who maybe if you don't watch the Air Amazings, you're curious about the fact as to how I decide if I'm going to put up a video on my channel. A lot of people have been asking me, Sin, do you only put up videos that you do good in or that you look like a badass in, or do you just put up every single video? And the answer is a little bit of A and a little bit of B. My job, first and foremost, is to provide entertaining content to everyone here on my YouTube channel or streaming, etc. And if I have a Dota 2 game that I, let's just say, hypothetically, I play Sniper in a game, and I decide, like, hey, I'm going to record this one. So I random Sniper, I read up about it, and then, like, I can go 0-10, and the game can last, like, 55 minutes. I'm not going to put that on YouTube. I'm just not going to. And Big O the Slayer says, just spent all day marathoning and love the Air Amazing. Harry, I appreciate it, man. Very much appreciate it. Welcome out to the show. But back on topic here, the problem with Dota is that it would take me 35 minutes to an hour to figure out whether or not this is going to be a useful video. Whereas there's been a couple of Air Amazings that I have not, I ended up deleting because they were just flat out a boring game. I don't mind showing my bad side. I don't mind showing me doing terrible or me yelling at my teammates or anything like that. That's just who I am. I'm not a care bear. I can be very nice and relaxed, but like I said, I'm at my worst when I am competing. And I don't fly off the handle like I used to when I was younger, but I certainly do not hold back either. But I don't censor myself on that. And it's not because I want to hide, like, oh, I have to put on this really, really good public front so people don't really know that I'm like a raging alcoholic druggie or whatever. But there is a certain level of quality control that I do instill on all my videos. And the problem with Dota is just the amount of time it takes to actually complete the game. And right now, I don't have any solid plans on how to implement the Air Amazing City series into Dota 2. But I will say that I'm trying to work on it. If you have an idea out there, feel free to email me, sinvicta316@gmail.com. I check my email every single day. And I actually set up, finally, I begrudgingly set up a Windows Live Mail, association with all of my inboxes. So now I can get instant notification. I hate using mail clients, but When you have as many email addresses as I do that do all kinds of different business, you just pretty much have to do that. So, but anyway, if you do have any sort of idea that sounds good to implement Air Amazing or something similar to it for Dota 2, let me know. Shoot me an email. Drop me a comment down below. Sinvicta316@gmail.com. Moving on here to the hypothetical. This is the one that everybody has been waiting to answer. Please start posting those hypothetical answers now. I will give you the topic. Hypothetically speaking, if dogs were as smart as humans since the beginning of time, would they have ever been able to become the most dominant species on Earth, or would it still be humans? I have my answer, and it may actually surprise you because my answer, I feel like, is not going to match other people's. So again, start putting those answers down below. Hashpon says the only difference is greater. Only difference is greater intelligence. Yes, it is. You are talking about a dog that is just as smart or smarter than the average human. Now, obviously, with humans, and I am a beacon of this example, humans can be dumber than other humans. So take the average IQ of a human and put that towards a dog being that or equal or greater than that. Than that IQ, and would they have become the most dominant species on Earth? And again, I'll give everyone a couple more seconds to start typing their answers out here. Again, hypothetically speaking, is one of the little fun bits that I like to do every now and then on SS Radio. I believe the most popular hypothetical was probably the spider one. People still send me messages talking about the spider one. If you don't know what I'm talking about, as I'm waiting for more answers to come in. If you don't know what I'm talking about, the most popular hypothetical was I believe it was something like, if spiders were as large as their, throw physics out the window, and if spiders were as large as their video game counterpart, like the size of spiders in Path of Exile or Diablo 2 or World of Warcraft, would they have become the most dominant species? And majority of the people said no, because the spiders, even though they're large, even though they would have probably seen humans as a food source and back in the ancient times, which I'm sure they would have, people still feel like humans' intelligence, the intelligence level of humans would have been able to outsmart them. We would have still had weapons, that sort of thing, and we would have been able to keep the population of spiders under control to the point where they'd be probably as dangerous as, like, say, a Siberian tiger or a lion. But now we are talking about dogs, and we're talking about dogs who are just as smart or smarter than humans. And the difference between that is dogs are much smarter just by themselves. They're much smarter than spiders. And if they are as smart as humans, they would have the ability to communicate. They would have the ability to organize, that sort of thing. Would they have rivaled or even surpassed humans? I will give you my answer after I read a couple of people, a couple of the answers in chat. And again, even if you do miss the live show, please post your answers down below here on YouTube. And I love to respond to these type of questions. So here we go. I'm going to be taking these straight from Twitch chat, and then I'll give you my answer before we wrap up the show with the final topic. Hashpot says the only difference is greater intelligence. Yes. Let's see here. Octopode. I'm pretty sure that's how you say his name. I'm going to go with no, because lack of thumbs makes dogs unable to properly exploit the increased intelligence. Big O the Slayer says humans would still be dominant. Evan says, I think humans would still be dominant, but I feel that there would be more of an equal relationship between man and dog. Masturbator says that the dogs don't need thumbs, they can just maul you. Rotate Al says that we would still have guns, and Mass D says they would too, but they would have no way to fire it, or at least... If dogs are smart as humans, they would have the ability to make their own tools. So that is not out of the question, dogs with guns, just saying. Let's see here. Nasty Cloud says no. Due to the simple ability of opposable thumbs, they allow us to build things, make us dominant. Sorar says yes, because dogs are now smarter than humans, so they avoid aggravating humans for their own survival. If dogs were as smart as humans, they would be less intelligent and seek world dominance out of arrogance. Hashpon says okay, people would still rule opposable thumbs, and upright walking takes the cake. I disagree with that 100%. Sadat says, well, it depends on if they want to dominate over humans. Now saying if they did, they have claws and teeth, they would be able to have taken our spears, since dogs originated from through domestication, et cetera, et cetera. It may have inhibited our development of guns, and which would be our only way of preventing them from becoming a dominant species. And also, P.S., I don't like dogs. Ubrand says, dogs would adapt stuff to their hands. That's one of my points. Hashpond says, you can't make tools with paws. Yes, but they have other options. Just because monkeys did it doesn't mean the dogs wouldn't be able to if they're as smart as us. Octopode says, paws just can't grip. And Mass D says, if people with no arms can dress themselves, I think dogs can make tools. I agree. Octopode says, again, dogs are already pretty good at hunting. There's not much that intelligence without tools would help them with that, I think. All right. So for the most part, people seem to be focusing on the fact that dogs won't have thumbs, and that would somehow hinder them in their world dominance. And well, Enigma just wrote an entire novel, so I'm not going to overlook his comment because he actually put a lot of thought to it. So here we go. I'm going to read one more, and I'll give you my I will give you my answer. Enigma 1097 here on Twitch says, I don't think they would manage to overtake us, even though early on they would have been able to contain us while also covering a wider area, assuming we're following the migration out of Africa theory. While we're working on development, increased weaponry to compensate. However, that we're assuming that they would be able to communicate, which we probably would be capable of working together to dominate together, especially given that alternatives would be both populations would be decimated. And one thing that I will say is, Enigma also, at the tail end there, he tacked on, but our Ogans are exposed to their teeth and claws easier than theirs. And that is something that I will say. First and foremost, I probably should have made this little annotation, I guess, in this hypothetical, is assuming that dogs wanted to take over the world as the dominant species, would they have been able to? Let's put it that way. Because some people are saying that, you know, humans and dogs share a natural bond, which I truly believe. They didn't want that. They just cast it aside and they wanted to be the rulers and sole dominators of the world. Then would they be able to, and that sort of thing? And I'll give you my idea. Now again, people are still focusing on the fact that dogs would not have thumbs. And again, I don't think that would have impeded them their ability to be able to stop us or kill us or hunt us, whatever. Again, just because apes and monkeys and primates were able to evolve to the point where we had opposable thumbs, if you believe in that sort of thing. And I'm not even going to start it. Nope. Stop. Don't even try to get into the religion evolution debate. You can take that junk and toss it out the window. That is not what this show is about. But if primates were able to do it, I feel like dogs, had they had equal intelligence, they probably would have been able to fashion weaponry that they would be able to use if they just do not decide to incorporate what they already have naturally, which is their claws and their teeth. One versus one, if you are an average human being, so let's say if you are the average height of a human being, let's just say is 5'7", and you weigh about 160 to 175 pounds, if we call that an average human for the modern day human, take that person, male or female, it doesn't matter because they're in a life or death situation. No weapons, it is just what you have, nails, claws, teeth, and feet, versus a dog, which is, let's just say, the common run-of-the-mill Rottweiler, which is about, a large Rottweiler can average around 120, 130 pounds. I mean, that's a pretty big dog. And that's actually overshooting. I'd say a Rottweiler is around 80 to 100 pounds, let's put it that way. Who would I take in a one-on-one? Both of them are smart enough. Both of them knowing that it's only going to be one or the other who lives or dies, based on physical attributes, speed, agility, and strength, I give it to the dog hands down all the time. I do not see any way, unless the human somehow was able to get the jump on the dog and get behind him and break its neck, I do not see any way that a dog would lose in that regard if the dog was smart enough to know that this is a battle to the death, only one person's leaving, etc., etc. I do not see it happening. If dogs had the ability and the intelligence enough to fashion weaponry, and let's just assume that they didn't, because people are still talking about the opposable thumb theory in chat, I still think that dogs would have certainly given a running for the humans. I don't know, honestly, if they would have had the ability to... I don't think if dogs had the ability, I'm not sure if they would have the ability to build structures and that sort of thing without the thumb. So I will give the opposable thumb theorists out there credit for that. But it's certainly not out of the question. I do think, like I said, I do think if a dog was smart enough as a human or smarter than the average human, if they wanted to, they probably could have taken over the world at some point. Like someone said, I think it was Enigma talking about if in the ancient times or in the ancestral times where people were developing weaponry and whatnot, if dogs had caught wind of that, I think that they would have probably saw that as a threat to their dominance and they probably would have stopped it. Again, this is assuming that the species are at war with each other. Now, realistically speaking, like I said, everyone knows that I'm a dog person. I absolutely hate cats. In my opinion, cats are nothing more than glorified pest controls. They're thankless animals, and that is about that. But dogs, on the other hand, dogs are very special in my opinion. I do believe they share some sort of a weird hippie theory, gypsy, whatever the hell hipster you want to call it, spirit bond, if you want to be as lame as that. But I do feel like that there's a general natural sense of bonding when it comes to a human and a dog that is not found in really any other parts of, in the animal kingdom, except maybe with dolphins and whales. But... you know, if all three of my dogs, we did lose one of our basset hounds, but let's just hypothetically say that my two basset hounds and my Shih Tzu decided that they wanted to fight me for dominance, and they're going to be their same physical size, but they are smarter or as smart as I am. Would I lose that fight? The answer is no, because I'm physically stronger and bigger. They may be faster than me, but I am physically stronger than all of my dogs put together times like 10. The only dog that I've ever had that may have had some sort of physical strength gap closer over me was probably the English Bull Mastiff that we had. And I do remember that he tried to test me one time by biting my arm, and I put that to rest very, very quickly. And that was the last time he ever challenged me. But given with those arguments, you know, if the dogs are smarter, that doesn't necessarily make them bigger than you. Yeah, but there's also big dogs out there, and there's also mean dogs. So it's a fun, and yeah, I mean, chat is still exploding right now. Rotate Al saying, one-on-one, a dog would win with no tools. I completely agree. Like I said, if you take a 5'7", 5'8", human, 150, 160 pounds, doesn't matter what the gender, put him up against an 80-pound to 100-pound human, intelligent, buffed Rottweiler, I'm going to take the dog 100% of the time. I don't see anything that happens. Rotate Al says, four dogs versus four random people. The dogs win if the dogs are as smart as humans. Yeah, there is not a situation... Environmental effects out the window. I'm saying just straight up natural born abilities, our gifts, if you want to call them that. You won't be able to outbite a dog. You won't be able to outrun a dog. You will not be able to outjump a dog. You won't be able to certainly fool a dog, especially if they're as smart as a human. Who wins that? It's going to be the dog. Nasty Clown says, I can rip out a throat or an eye with my fingers. The dog can't win. I don't know. If you've seen some mean dogs, dogs can be pretty brutal, man. They go straight for the jugular. They know that they can, especially if they're smart humans, they know how powerful their jaws are. They will use that to their advantage, rip off an arm, rip off a foot, or at least cripple you to the point. I mean, most dogs go for the Achilles. Most people do know that attack dogs do know about the Achilles heel of humans. Disable the Achilles tendon, and that human is done dizzle. He is not walking. He certainly is not bowling or ripping out eyes for the rest of the week. But again, that is hypothetically speaking. It's a lot of fun. We do like to talk about a lot of different things, a myriad of whether it be the most tasty Pokemon or whether or not you could beat a dog in a one-on-one fight. That sort of thing. It's a lot of fun. Again, if you've never seen an SS Radio before, check it out on the live stream whenever I do it every Tuesday and Thursday here on twitch.tv/Invicta. I'm going to wrap up the show really quickly here before we end it tonight. Going to be updating you on the Word of Lauder album. For those of you who don't know what it is or what I am doing on the side, I am a musician. I'm in a band called the Word of Lauder. You may have heard a couple of my songs. In fact, you actually just heard a song 44 minutes ago when I played the introduction, which Crane Song, Sparse Vector, Sailmar Vesper, and Tempo, and the other guys actually appear on there. That is actually my band. That is one of our songs, which we actually just finished. We just finished up, and that one's done. So, but the Word of Lauder album is almost finished. We are working on, I believe this is going to be the second or the final song, second to last or the final song of the album, and then I will start preparations to doing the artwork and whatnot, to working on the music videos, et cetera, et cetera. And then when it is released, I promise you everyone will know. I'm going to make sure that everybody knows on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, yada, yada, yada. And I've already talked about how I plan distributing it. But if you don't know what I'm talking about, this is my plan for the Word of Lauder album. Again, I'm not planning on ever selling it. You can find track one, which is called Thrive. You can find that on iTunes, but I don't recommend you buying it. In fact, I would prefer you don't buy it through iTunes. Again, if you are looking to support the band, there are many different ways that you can easily find my PayPal address that I've set up for this very purpose only, which is to donate to support whatever I do, and the album is one of those, because I am paying for everything out of the album out of pocket, and I do have to pay for studio time and recording and rendering and that sort of thing. But what I plan on doing is, after the album is done, I will be making a public release. I'll probably stream the entire album while I'm playing video games or just sitting here talking about it. You can expect full music videos that I will be producing and editing myself. And a lot of people ask me if I'm going to do a live action hero. No. People ask me if I'm going to be doing a live action video for it, and the answer is no. I do not have the money or the time to really finance out a couple of actors, or even me renting a very good camera, going out in like the woods, shooting like a creek, and then that's that. That's not going to happen. I would much rather use a medium that I'm actually well versed in, or at least semi competent in, which is going to be video editing through After Effects and Sony Vegas. So you can expect to see official music videos for every single song. You can expect to find download links where you can download the album for free. It's going to be on a pay-what-you-feel basis, so that means that I'm not doing it with any sort of monetary gain in mind, but you have to understand, realistically speaking, mature people will know that things in this life are not free, and I certainly do not want to stop people who do want to support myself or the album. There's going to be the PayPal account. You can donate to it. You can donate as much as you want or as little as you want. If you just want to toss in a dollar, just say, hey, thanks a lot, no problem. If you want to not pay anything, no problem. If you want to pay a $4 million for it, I don't know why you would, but hey, no problem at all with that. I do not believe in the whole tier of donation things. I'm not going to be doing it like, if you donate $10, you get like a autograph, you know, picture of me, or, you know, if you donate $100, then you get your own signed version. I don't believe in any of that stuff. This is not a Kickstarter thing. I bought it. I paid for everything. I'm going to release it. That's that. I don't believe in the reward system, at least not for something like this. But I'm starting to get very, very excited and very nervous. Because I do know that it is going to be a busy time for me when the album is finally done, because that means that I'm going to have to kick it into high gear and put a lot of the content on YouTube on hold, because I need to get out the music videos. I need to work on promotional material. I need to start spreading the word out, get it out to, you know, not record labels, because I'm not. By the way, people have asked me, are we planning on touring anytime soon? The answer is no. We are strictly a studio band. My rock star days are long in the past. There was a time where I would have been like, yeah, let's go rock star, heavy metal, rock on, man. But now it's like, I'm too old for that. And the rest of the guys in the band are married with kids, so that's not going to happen. We're strictly a studio band. But what I will say is that after the album is paid for, in one way or another, whether it be through YouTube video, getting AdSense generation from my YouTube channel, or from people donating, once the album is paid for pretty much in full, what I will say is that money will go to supporting the next album, because what I plan on doing is I plan on enlisting the help of the guys in the band. The other guys in the band, by the way, are Mark, who is on our guitars, and he does most of the writing. Craig, who is our mixer, and also he does the bass tracks as well. And then Nick, who is the vocalist, who's done all the vocals except for a couple parts in the latest song, which I actually took over for vocals. What I would like to do is keep making music like this, like to entertain everybody and to use for my videos. I want to make good music that people would want to use in their videos. Again, the whole point for me doing this album was to go hand in hand with the Word of Law series, my World of Warcraft PvP series. And I'm pretty sure it's never been done before. And correct me if I'm wrong, but even people like Swifty or Bajira or, you know, or Wreckful or anything like that, I'm pretty sure that no one in the history of making Warcraft videos has ever written and produced a full-length or funded a full-length studio album for the sole purpose of their videos. And obviously I don't play WoW anymore, and Lauder is sitting on a beach drinking a Mai Tai right now. He is on break for a while. But the whole point of that was for me to make these songs that I can use in my videos, and then at the end release it so people who are Warcraft authors, or even Star Wars: The Old Republic, or any authors, Counter-Strike, whatever, any new media authors, say, hey, here's some really badass heavy metal songs. You can use them for your own good as long as it is not for a commercial purpose, and you don't have to worry about copyright. That's it. And when you do indeed download the album, there is going to be a built-in EULA that states for the record that you are not allowed to make any money using any of the songs or parts of the songs or anything like that. Fair trade does not go that way because it is a free-to-pay basis. You are voluntarily agreeing to the EULA. That is how that works there. And obviously, I'm stupid, but I'm not that stupid. I do have to watch out for my IP, and I have to watch out for the other guys' name and IP as well. Because there are people who would take advantage of really good music for free and try to make money off of it. So that's not going to happen. But the point is that you can put these on YouTube. You can don't have to worry about copyright. You don't have to worry about content matches. Again, I give everyone permission to use them in a non-commercial-based oriented type deal. And if people do send it off to, like, say, Razor, for example, and say, hey, Path to Morning sounds a really good song, we want to use that, then that's when I will be talking behind the scenes about letting them use it for commercial purposes. But for the average Joe or the average new media content producer or the average Minecrafter or Warcrafter or anything like that, they can use it. They don't have to worry about it. Put it on YouTube. You got awesome music. There you go. You just can't make money off of it, that sort of thing. So to sum it all up, it is almost done. I am looking forward to sharing the album with everyone. I'm looking forward to the release party. I have to think of something very, very cool to do. What I'm thinking about doing, and this is something that I've only started recently thinking about for the release party, I think once the album is done, what I will probably do is set up a live stream where it's me and the rest of the guys in the band. We're probably just going to be drinking and talking about pretty much anything that goes on in the songs. Like, we'll play a song or two and then see what the chat thinks, talk about it, you know, reveal the writing process. I don't know if people are going to be interested in that or whatnot. Most people just see me play video games and be a complete dumbass, because I am. But who knows? Let me know what you'd like to see about the T-Wall album, a party, and whatnot. Again, you can email me, sinvicta316@gmail.com. And Hashpawn says your PayPal is linked to your Hotmail. That's correct. Yeah, I set up the PayPal account through Hotmail because that was the only email that I had at the time. And I didn't even want to set up the PayPal account, but I made it so fans could make donations if they chose for. But again, I will never, ever put any of my content out behind a paywall or anything like that. All my content will always be free, and I will never actively like panhandle for donations, because I'm just not like that. But thank you again for watching SS Radio number 94. Stick around for the post-game wagon adventure. We'll see if Sorar can continue the win streak, or will someone else like TGS David brutally murder her, and yeah, we'll see if Sorar will survive. Thank you very much for watching. We'll see you Thursday evening, same bat time, same bat channel. Good night now.